Please welcome J.J. Abrams.
All children growing up have their idols. Athletes and movie stars are common role models. But I knew I'd never be asked to star in a movie, and I couldn't throw a ball. So my idol was Norman Lear. I watched a lot of TV as a kid, and like many of you, I noticed a link, a common thread, that ran through all the great shows. Mr. Lear's name appeared always as the producer, usually also as script supervisor, and I took note. When I grew up, I said to myself, I want to be like Norman Lear. In 1982, Norman Lear gave an amazing interview on PBS's Open Mind, in which he laid out the principles behind the creation of the People for the American Way. Also, during that same time period, he made a remarkable television ad, you saw a clip earlier, featuring a tough, blue-collar forklift operator, letting the nation know how he felt about ministers and the religious right, telling people like him that his views needed to match theirs. In a way, this ad made history, for it generated such a huge public response when it aired that it led to the founding of this very organization. These are two in a lifetime of extraordinary moments, not just for what they accomplished back then and their role in defining the debate over the next 30 years, but for what they say about Norman. Think about the courage that took for a man at the height of his career, a television legend who redefined the genre, to be willing to step away from that life and dedicate his time and his talent for something he so passionately believed in. How many people have demonstrated that kind of courage? How many have demonstrated that kind of commitment? Two come to mind, Muhammad Ali and Norman Lear. To this day, by the way, either one of them could kick my ass. What is truly extraordinary about Norman is that he has never wavered in his commitment to the People for the American Way. He didn't start this organization and walk away. Year in and year out, he's been there as his driving force. And now, 30 years after the founding of this organization, Norman is still fighting the good fight, and his message is as relevant and vibrant today as it was back then.
I have a problem. I'm religious. Well, we're a religious family, but that don't mean we see things the same way politically. Now, here come certain preachers on radio and TV and in the mail telling us on a bunch of political issues that there's just one Christian position and implying if we don't agree, we're not good Christians. So my son is a bad Christian on two issues. My wife is a good Christian on those issues, but she's a bad Christian on two others. Lucky me, I'm 100% Christian because I agree with the preacher on all of it. Now, my problem is, I know my boy is as good a Christian as me. My wife, she's better. So maybe there's something wrong when people, even preachers, suggest that other people are good Christians or bad Christians, depending on their political views. That's not the American way.
Norman Lear has recently joined with Father Theodore Hesburgh, the president of Notre Dame, with former Congresswoman Barbara Jordan, and with a distinguished array of other educators, theologians, popular figures in government and business, in founding and then directing what they call People for the American Way.
What People for the American Way hopes to do, in part, or to begin to seed, is some understanding that the traditional American values of freedom of speech and expression, of religious tolerance, of that spirit of liberty that Leonard Hand talked about, wherein we view the other fellow's point of view with the same kind of understanding and appreciation with which we'd like our point of view viewed, that these values are worth holding on to, and we mustn't be divided at a time when we are simply anxious, frustrated, and people are offering us these simple answers to complex problems. I would wish each individual to have the right to speak out so long as there isn't any imminent danger to anyone else as a result of that. But I would also wish, and it pleases me to be able to say in this free society, hey fellas, the spirit of liberty is demeaned and devalued when you tell another human being that they are less of a Christian because they disagree with you politically.
To me, Norman Lear has always had two sides, the man who is in the present, fighting for what is right in the here and now, and the visionary, who's ahead of his time. He's made a difference for me, for all of us, for anyone who believes in the American way. And with his commitment with Michael Keegan to building a movement and organization of young people, he's making a difference for the next generation and generations to come. I felt it as a kid, and I feel it now. When I grow up, I want to be like Norman Lear. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the man who proves 90 is the new 30, Mr. Norman Lear.
No medication, you're by lesbian, transgender life. I'm on the right track, baby, I was born to survive. No matter black, white, or beige, should I orient me? I'm on the right track, baby, I was born to be brave.
Thank you, J.J. To be lauded by you, someone I admire so much whose work is current and deep and penetrating and gorgeous, I couldn't be touched more. And I couldn't admire or respect you more as a man, a talent, and a spirit. You who don't know J.J. Abrams, visit his offices where he works. Spend 10 minutes there. He doesn't have to be there, and you'll know the man. His space, just his space alone, reveals his strength, his genius, and his empathy. Thank you so much, J.J. May I call you Jay? And please know how proud I am to share this stage with a remarkable talent, philanthropist, citizen, and friend, Alec Baldwin. I'm so touched by my role. My role in your life, if I did nothing else but help deliver you to the people you entertain so wonderfully, I would be a big success. People for the American Way has been blessed to have Alec on its board, bringing with him every bit of the brilliance and the passion he brings to his work. And how do I thank you, Carl and Rob? My God, we go back so many more years than 30 years. I remember Rob playing jacks with my daughter Ellen. They were the same age. They were 7 or 8 years old on Fire Island one summer, and Rob, even then, having been around so many Jewish comics all his young life, he would talk to her. No, you don't do that. You pick up the bat. You bounce the ball before you pick up the legs. You don't like that. And I said to his dad, I said, kid is funny. What are you talking about? Mary Kay Place, I adore you. I loved you the first minute I met you. I saw instant, I don't know, you had it then, you have it now, and I so appreciate your friendship. Dolores, you are my hero. What can I say? One of the great women of the Western world. Jane Lynch. So we're talking 30 years here. You're so relatively new in all of our lives, but already, you know, you've added time to all of those lives. I have so many friends among all of you, so many. I'm looking into so many faces I so respect and admire, and I am so grateful for. Thank you for being here. It is the 30th anniversary of People for the American Way. You honor me for having had something to do with it and a reasonable amount to do with keeping it relevant and effective. You raised this evening alone over $1.5 million. Just honoring Alec and me. And you pay me all of these great words and the additional honor of allowing me to close the evening that celebrates all of that. But please, don't for a second be concerned whether this is all too much for me. I can take it. That probably comes as a consequence of my age. I do get a kick out of my age. Just getting out of a chair and crossing the room gets me applause now. And I can't believe how wise I've become. A simple good morning is thought to hold deep meaning. Now, if any of you are thinking that at my age a fellow may believe he's earned the right to feel that way, I want to tell you that if I live to be 99, 109, I wouldn't feel I earned it. And I have my mother to thank for that. Many, many years ago, she visited us in Los Angeles for a couple of weeks. Actually, I sent a car to Connecticut to drive her to JFK. I met her with a wheelchair at the curb. I pushed her up to the plane myself, brought her to LA first class. And when I tell you we did everything, I mean we did everything to show her a good time. We took her to a couple of previews we might not have gone to, and to a few dinner parties, introduced her to all the Carol O'Connors, Bea Arthurs, all the Reiners and Mel Brookses of my life. We took her to a cocktail party to meet Walter Matthau and Gregory Peck, brought her to a book signing for Groucho Marx, screened a film for her where she met Paul Newman. We did everything we could to show her a good time. When her visit was concluded, and I was driving her to the airport for her flight home, first class, she said to me, "Norman, sweetheart, when I get home to Bridgeport and you talk to someone back there, if you hear that I told a little white lie, I don't want you to be upset." So why, I asked. She said, "Well, a little white lie, what does it matter?" Mother, what little white lie might you be telling? "Oh, well, just remember, you're talking to your sister, your cousin Esther, and you hear, Mother, I begged. What are you talking about? Why would you have to tell a little white lie?" And she said, "Who has to know that I didn't get to Las Vegas?" Swear to God. Many of you heard the story before, but she gets such a great reception. I'll tell it again. One morning, when I learned that the Television Academy of Arts and Sciences was starting a Hall of Fame, and I would be among its first inductees, along with Bill Paley, General Sarnoff, Patty Chayefsky, Edward R. Murrow, Lucille Ball, Milton Berle, and me, I called her immediately in Bridgeport, and I told her. And she said, "Listen, if that's what they want to do, who am I to say?" Would you believe I have 75 years of those stories? But I can't believe it has been 30 years since I was startled by the proliferation of TV evangelicals across radio and television. Jerry Falwell, Jimmy Swaggart, Paul Robeson, Pat Robertson, among others, mixing politics and religion and reminding me, when I was 9 and 10 years old, of listening to Father Coughlin on the radio, ranting against Franklin Roosevelt, liberals, the New Deal, and in his case, Jews. I decided to take them all on with a film and started writing a script I called Religion, hoping to savage those TV ministries, much the way Patty Chayefsky savaged the networks. And then one morning, I'm watching the Reverend Jimmy Swaggart, and I see him ask his viewers, his TV congregation, to pray for the removal of a Supreme Court justice. And it scared the hell out of me. I couldn't wait the two or more years it would take to write a script, make a film. So I made that TV spot you saw a bit earlier, of the blue-collar worker. I paid to run it on a TV station, a local TV station in D.C., and it caused so much talk that all three networks, there were only three at the time, ran it on their 7 o'clock news. And like an act of spontaneous combustion, People for the American Way was born. From that day to this, I haven't awakened and read my newspapers any morning when I didn't thank God that People for was there. I take great comfort knowing we have active members and supporters in 50 states, activists who wish for everyone the freedom to read any book or movie of their choice, or see any movie of their choice, create or appreciate even the most challenging art. People who believe the government has no business telling us who or how to love. Members and supporters who truly believe in equal justice and equal opportunity under the law. Who appreciate to their toes the blessings of an independent judiciary, and who couldn't appreciate more that wonderful D.C. staff in our headquarters, who are the professional People for the American Way, the ones who fight for these principles day in and day out, 24/7. For the 30 years People for the American Way, now under the leadership of that lovely gentleman you saw earlier, the indefatigable Michael Keegan, providing... They provided much of the eternal vigilance that the protection of our civil rights and of liberties required. Our government, no matter the party, no matter the party in power, it aches me to say, was of no help in this regard. Often quite the contrary. For example, 30 years ago, we had something called the Fairness Doctrine. The Fairness Doctrine, enforced by the FCC. And it held that the media provides balance and objectivity in its news and discussion shows. So, for example, when People for the American Way saw Pat Robertson espousing only one point of view on a political matter, and on a religious broadcast at that, we notified the FCC, and that ministry, sometimes the entire Christian Broadcasting Network, was forced to provide us with equal time to respond. Doesn't that sound right? Fair and balanced news reporting? Where have we heard that before? People for used the Fairness Doctrine so effectively until it was repealed in 1987. On May 13, 1982, I received this letter from Pat, the Reverend Pat Robertson, president of the Christian Broadcasting Network. He wrote, "Dear Norman, last week your organization challenged our program on KTLA in Los Angeles, and yesterday the sales manager of KTLA called our headquarters and said, quote, if you discuss anything political on your program next week, we will take it off the air. Norman, you are not merely trying to silence a member of the press. You are trying to silence a prophet of God. I warn you with all solemnity, Norman, your arms are too short to box with God. The suppression of the voice of God's servant is a terrible thing. God himself will fight for me against you, and he will win. I remain yours sincerely, Pat Robertson." Unfortunately, too many of us on the left, to the left of center, tend to laugh at such as this. I am chilled by it. With good reason, because once on October 1st, 1981, hundreds of thousands of people across the country belonging to the moral majority received these words in a newsletter from Jerry Falwell. Dear friends, I am about to name the man that some people believe to be the greatest threat to the American family in our generation, Norman Lear. He went on to talk about the filth and sexual perversion that my shows brought into America's living rooms, but calling me the greatest threat to the American family earned me some hate mail and death threats, one so threatening that my family and partners insisted I secure protection. This religiously stoked hatred threatens humanity everywhere across the globe today, and it is very alive in our America as well, and most threatening when it comes with a partisan political tinge. People for the American Way has stood as a bulwark against that in the press, in the media, and by example. When we produced a two-hour special, I Love Liberty, years ago, our co-chairs were Gerald Ford and Lady Bird Johnson. On the stage, we had Barry Goldwater, John Wayne, and Jane Fonda, all contributing to the idea that fight as we may over policy and ideology, we stand united when it comes to basic American principles. We continue to work toward that end today. 6 weeks ago, my people for the American Way credentials quite intact, I accepted an invitation to accompany Nancy Reagan to the Republican debate at the Reagan Library. Her husband, with whom I had a friendly, however contentious, relationship, would have been happy to see me there, I know. That civility is so unlike anything we hear from the Republican candidates as they battle each other. Newt Gingrich, like the others, cloaks everything he says in a kind of bumper sticker religiosity. We, on the left, have ceded the God and values talk to the right, and I think it's been a big mistake. The what's it all about, Alfie, questions make for the best conversations going. I consider myself as much a believer, as religious, if you will, as the best guy, as the next guy. But it's my belief system. I have thanked whatever and whoever is responsible for my being alive with every wake-up. Virtually every time I've bitten into a ripe peach, or looked into my children's eyes, or enjoyed a great laugh in a group, I've been grateful, often to the point of tears. I once asked a great theologian and friend in Vermont to give me the shortest definition he could of worship. He gave it to me in one word: gratitude. You don't agree with that? No problem, as long as you don't decry it. If worship for you means going to a church or a synagogue or a mosque, reading from a specific sacred text, wonderful. Or if you choose not to believe, wonderful. I offered my life in a war for you to believe whatever you may do, whatever you do. But it is also... Thank you. But it is also my view that we humans and our faith systems are so gloriously complex that you can take any amount of people sitting in the same pews, knee to knee, every Sunday of their lives, reading and praying from the same sacred text, and like no two snowflakes, like no two thumbprints, no two compacts with the Almighty will be the same. The way we think and feel and relate to the deity is unique to each of us. Our founders clearly understood that there'd be a level of separation between church and state. I've just been trying to build a wall of understanding, of common sense, to go along with the notion that it's a poor idea to mix politics and religion, and a good idea to back that caution with laws that make that very clear. For 30 years, I've brought my perspective to People for the American Way and linked arms and minds and spirits with people of all faiths and experiences who have brought their unique perspective to the work of the organization. What unites us are the promises and guarantees of our founding documents. and the precise language with which they are expressed. The majority of words and phrases like endowed by their creator with the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, the constitutional guarantee of equal justice under the promise of equal opportunity for all. Then there are the last words of the Declaration of Independence, where the founders pledged their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor. Sacred honor. It feels antique now, doesn't it? We don't sense much of that today. The last time I came across sacred honor, I was watching The Godfather. I want to suggest that we lefties start laying claim to what we see as sacred and serve it up proudly to the religious right, to the James Dobson, Rush Limbaugh, Glenn Peck, Beck, Karl Rove, all those hate mongers sheathed in sanctity, and to the Koch brothers, the types that fund them and use them so effectively for their own political power-grabbing purposes. Over the past several decades, the power-grabbing right has built a powerful infrastructure, radio and TV stations and networks. They've built think tanks, colleges, and law schools, and funded political groups that prepped all the way for the Supreme Court in Citizens United to grant corporations the right to provide any amount of financial backing to a candidate or a cause, just like any other average citizen. And all of it carried with an air of holier-than-thou sanctity. No less apparent than Pat Robertson when he told me my arms were too short to box with God. And now, as frightening as it is, where do we find that holier-than-thou sanctity most apparent in politics today? Among the seven candidates attempting to prove in every debate that we have seen that they are the right kind of Christian to be the Republican candidate for the presidency of the United States. In light of the circumstances we liberals and progressives have succumbed to, it is hard to remember that we, not the right, we are the spiritual heirs to those Americans who struggled to end slavery and segregation, to end child labor and win safe conditions and a living wage for workers. And we are the spiritual heirs to those who conceived of and fought for just about every bit of social legislation in the last century, legislation that everyone, left and right, now take for granted. And that resulted, not that many years ago, in the most flourishing, hopeful, and empowered middle class in the history of nations. Big change since then. And yet, despite being the spiritual heirs to all of that, it is the right that presumes ownership of everything that pertains to God and to the flag. Looking to the future, I will rely on People for the American Way and its sons and daughters in Young People For and the young elected officials you saw earlier to continue to fight that for that wall of separation between government and religion. I will rely on them to ensure that equal protection of the law covers all Americans, no matter their race, religion, or sexual orientation. And I will rely on them to claim their share of God and the flag by acknowledging that the God for all believers on the right is the same God for all believers on the left as well. And that no one side can lay sole claim to the family values, patriotism, and all the other good stuff that stems from that source. I really wanted to say what I've just said so much tonight. I am so grateful for your attention, for the opportunity to speak it to you, for your coming here to celebrate this evening, for Alec and myself. Thank you and God bless you. And thank you.